life.
What is the subject which provoked and inspired tens of papers cannot be a subject for publication? For a very simple reason. About 20 years ago, Professor Rainer Stiefel from Münster discovered a crucial new testimony, a Greek version of the inscription on the chalice. This text has been presented by Professor Stiefel and distributed in many seminars and in many conferences, but this text to this day has not been published. As long as this text is not published, no one can actually present a meaningful publication on the inscription without using Professor Stiefel's text, which is widely available. It has been distributed, as I said. But no one can publish this text instead of it. And there's no date for publication. And to that extent, for publication purposes, the subject is closed, because you cannot write on this inscription without using this testimony. So in the handout that I distributed Professor Stiefel's text with indication that this text was discovered by him and transcribed by him. Since my talk is not destined for publication, this subject will remain for the time being in the realm of oral discussion. Nevertheless, I believe that the subject needs to be discussed, because when Rainer Stiefel presented his discovery in various forums, for him this was a proof against the historicity of the life of Constantine. For him this was a proof that the life of Constantine integrates in the guise of an inscription that Constantine read on the chalice, an ancient apocryphon, which has actually nothing to do with Constantine and nothing to do with any specific chalice preserved or not in Constantinople. So to that extent, his argument is can be imagined as a sword of Damocles hanging over the life of Constantine for the last 15 years, threatening its historicity, threatening its historical veracity, and no one can actually respond because the text is not published, and I believe will not be published for a long time. Therefore, it appears to me useful to examine here anew the contents of the prophecy contained in the inscription on the cup, its relation to the existent two Greek versions. We will take into account the new Greek version, and the place of this prophecy, of this inscription, in the Vita Constantini. I remind, despite the fact that this is most of you no doubt know the background story, I remind you that according to the Constantine's life, in between two missions, in between his mission to Caesarea, which Professor Stiefel believed to be purely mythical, and his mission to Moravia, on which I don't know his opinion, Constantine spent some quiet time living in the Church of St. Apostles in Constantinople, and in the Scalophylaxion of the Riznica, of the great church of St. Sophia, he found an old cup manufactured for King Solomon, on which he read an inscription. Inscription prophesying the fate of Christ. This inscription is reproduced, that is, in Constantine's translations. It was basically in Hebrew. We'll say a few more words on its language. The inscription in Constantine's translation appears in the middle column, and the two Greek versions of the same text are on the left and on the right. On the left, you find a well-known Greek version of the text published by Ihor Shevchenko in 1967. On the right, the unpublished text discovered by Rainer Stifel. Before the comparison, I would like to make a few remarks on this text, which still presents a few problems. The basic background that is to the scene described as is, you remember, the sleepless night that Christ spent in Gethsemane, 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 after Passover and before his arrestation. This is the reference, Первенцу Ящу Ночью. This sleepless night is the context. The other element that needs to be taken into consideration, though it doesn't always happen, is the Byzantine perception, that is, at this occasion, as you remember, Christ in anguish prays to his Father, "May this cup go away from me." Translate the Greek literary, the cup is a metaphor of his suffering. What needs to be remembered is that in Byzantine iconographic tradition, post-iconoclastic iconographic tradition, this cup was visualized as a real cup. That is, you have, you know probably the scene of Christ praying, and a cup hanging in the air in front of him. That is, this is a fairly ancient and very common image. That also should be forgotten. With this reminder, let's read the text. The text is divided in three grani. Grani are verses, not in a poetic sense, but verses as divisions of text. This is an important term, on which I'll say a few words later. Есть же сица первая грань, чаша моя, пролицай, Донде же звезда? Here I will make a first remark. This, in Greek it's the same thing. Kratermu, kratermu, prophetilson, or prophetilwe. It's in the two different Greek versions. Eos u asta. In all translations that I saw, this text is understood. Until a star rises, which is kind of weird because that means that the prophecy is supposed to take place early in the evening, until you see the star. I don't think that that's the meaning. I think the meaning is until there is a star in the sky. That is, it's parallel to the vigil of Christ. That is, as long as there is a star, as long as the star stays in the sky before light. You see? That's that seems to me just a remark of common sense, but I will be very interested in your comments. В пиво буди Господи первенцу, Господи первенцу бдящую ночью. You'll serve for drinking by God's firstborn who keeps vigil at night. That's not particularly complicated, except for the fact that, of course, we'll have to ask the question, what he's supposed to drink from this cup? The answer will be fairly obvious. Посем же другая грань, then there is the next part of the text. На вкушение Господне створена древо иного, пьи и упийся весельем, и Alleluia. This is the most problematic part of this text, especially the first line of Кушение Господне створена древо иного. Most commentators avoid commenting this line. Mario Capaldo, who wrote 90 pages on this text, just translated in a note and didn't go into any particular commentaries. The only one bravely faced it and confronted it was Moshe Taub more than 20 years ago, in an article in which he proposed to explain Древо иного with иный, with the meaning of a single one. Yeah, a single. But all commentators agree that створена чаша, obviously, that this the cup was made out of some kind of different wood. Why is it so problematic? Because the text says that this cup was made out of precious stones. That's in the text of the life. And it's fairly obvious that you wouldn't keep in the Sceophylacium of St. Sophia a wooden cup. It's not serious. I think the meaning is different. I think that this cup was created. The cup was created, чаша створена, here I don't change the meaning, so that God may taste from the other tree. Yes. So that God may taste from the other tree. And I say the other tree and not another tree. Because Mario Capaldo, who attempted to retranslate this text into Greek, without knowing, of course, the text that will be discovered by Stichel about the time he wrote his article, translated and then we should look into the Greek, which is very revealing in this respect. The Greek says "xulu etero." Capaldo translated "albu xulu," that is a different word. Yes. But here is here we have the opposition "hutos heteros," the one, the other, so that God might taste from the other wood and the other tree. And of course, that then I think becomes obvious. The other tree is not the tree from which Adam and Eve tasted, which was the tree of knowledge. So that God may taste from the tree of life, the tree of life. And here the relevant reference is Revelation of John 2:7. Дам ясти от древа животного, еже есть посреди рая. So that he might taste of the other wood, that is, the wood of redemption, the wood which redeems the sin, which originated in the tasting from the first wood. That's, what do you think?
I love it.
If you like it, I'm satisfied. Okay. So from the other wood, and that's the dichotomy of the wood of life and the wood of knowledge, and of course how he tastes from the other wood in two ways. The process you all know is made of the wood of life, yeah? But the wood of life is also associated with the wine, with gefen.
With what?
Виноградное дерево.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. With wine, and here,
yeah,
and that's why he continues PUPCDCL, that is, the drinking I might suggest to the pious audience, the drinking is real, because if we go back to the biblical context, if we go back to Matthew, who is the only one who preserved this precious detail. Just before Christ's vigil in Gethsemane, he says the following sentence to his disciples after the Passover meal. I tell you, never again shall I drink from this fruit of the wine until that day when I drink it new, that is, I drink the wine, with you in the kingdom of my Father. So there is some real drinking involved, and I think Christ was looking towards it after the hard part is over. So I think the drinking is very much in the sequence of the, that is, fits very well into this context of Christ's vigil in Gethsemane. And then the third part, се князь и узрит весь сон славу и ударит Цезарь посреди них. And this, I think, that is, tons of paper was spent to explain these two lines. But I think, again, it's explained the best with this line that I just read to you, that is, of Christ drinking with the crowd of his people after the resurrection. So, well, that's just the introduction. My intention was not to deal with the contents of this text, but I still try to understand it. And in my understanding, since I'm not involved in the study of the Apocrypha, this text is very simple. It is built around two basic images. That is crucifixion, resurrection, expiation of the sin of Adam by tasting from the other wood, and the celebratory element which is involved. Do I still have a few minutes? Celebratory element which is very appropriate with this image of drinking, which is in the imagery. My main point, however, if you want to discuss more of the contents, we can do it if we have time. My main point, however, consists in comparing the Slavonic with the two Greek texts. Unfortunately, I'm afraid I don't have the time to comment on the two Greek texts as they would deserve to be commented. I will simply say that the text published by Shevchenko is much shorter, as you can see from the comparison. It's much shorter. It's missing quite a few elements, but it's much more presentable, I would say. It's presented in a correct Greek, and it's coherent, which you cannot say, and that's an interesting feature of the text discovered by Rainer Stichen, about the text discovered by Stichen. First of all, of course, in the text discovered by Stichen, we have the indication of four languages in which this inscription was supposed to be written. Samaritan, Greek, Latin, and Hebrew. Then, the first line is correct. Pratermu, pratermu, pro feteue, well, it's not an aorist imperative, but it doesn't change much. Eusu aster, eis po man, which is of course a grammatical mistake. Eso curio in ki, pro toku, egregorotus, bom. In Gregorotus, there's also a couple of grammatical mistakes, but that's not the problem. The problem is protoku. Prototoku is replaced protoku, and protoku has a meaning. It's before childbirth. So, someone who wrote this, who wrote down this text, obviously understood its meaning, but he didn't have a better version. Then it gets out of hand entirely. Trufen anabois. Cry the joy. Why? Perikopso. What does it mean, perikopso? Perikopto, it's an aorist imperative of perikopto, perikopto. Perikopto, which means to cut around. Cut around, in Byzantine Greek, that's also circumcise. What is this? An appeal to circumcision? A remnant of Cyril's Khazar mission, which is revealed only in this text. Unlikely, possible, but unlikely. But the word is there. Is geosimifes kiriu pseudoeteopim. Well, the rest is more or less correct, but abridged compared to the Slavonic text and to the parallel Greek text published by Shevchenko. The two Greek texts, obviously go back to one and the same translation. That is, they go back to one and the same translation. The question is, how do they go back to it? My hypothesis, which I can only formulate briefly because of the time restrictions, is that both were written down from memory. It's very plausible concerning the text of Shevchenko. It's practically certain concerning the text of discovered by Stichler. This text is so disheveled that it cannot be imagined as a copy of any text. And on this hypothesis, that the text was written down by memory from something resembling the translation that read as Slavonic, I can propose a hypothetical explanation for this mysterious pericopson. I can't explain it as an appeal to circumcision, that would be too daring. But I would remind you that in Byzantine Greek, the word pericope is a division of the text, which can be a good translation for grind. Yeah. That is, if someone reconstructs from memory, that and he remembers that this element is present at this particular place, as you can see from my table, that's where it is located. That's how it could be corrupted. That is, that's the only explanation that I can propose. And pericope and grind are very close in me. If we admit that there are two fixation in writing of a text transmitted orally, nothing prevents us from admitting, as has been suggested concerning the text published by Shevchenko, that here we have the Greek original of Constantine the philosopher's translation. That is because it's obvious that for his Moravian mission he had absolutely no reason to translate the inscription directly into Slavonic. He obviously translated it into Greek. There is absolutely no reason not to admit, not to make this assumption. The Greek version, which I am ready to accept as original, has certain literary pretenses. I wouldn't speak here about metric, we will not count syllables. I will simply point out that the correct term is poterion in Byzantine Greek. Correct term is poterion, which appears in the title, Epigramma isto poterion tou Solomontos. And this is a correct text because it's in the Bible. Because when Christ prays for this cup to go away, the term he uses is not kratir, the term he uses is poterion. But the word poterion is a four syllable. It can fit into any construction. And I suspect that this is a literary choice because whoever preserved this text, he knew that the right term is poterion, but for whatever reason, we need to call it kratir. If we admit that this, and I have to be short and I skip perhaps stages, if we admit that this Greek text go back to the translation by Cyril, we automatically admit that Saint Cyril translated an inscription written in Hebrew letters on a cup. If we admit that an inscription was written in Hebrew letters on a cup, in Samaritan letters, I will come to this point, on a cup prophesying Christ, then again we come back to the idea of Stichler that the life of Constantine can be historical, because it goes beyond my imagination that a prophecy on Christ and fairly late prophecy of Christ, let's put it that way, because this separation between the two trees is not very ancient, was written in Samaritan or Hebrew script. Who would write it? Or why would they write it? There we really have, but by proposing a solution to this problem, I will terminate my speech. Unlike most people here gathered, I have a certain personal experience in reading, deciphering, publishing inscriptions and papyri. And only my intrinsic modesty will prevent me from saying what I read on papyrus and on stone, which turned out not to have the slightest link to what was actually written there, if anything was written. I will further remind you, the students of the Apocrypha, of the case of your distinguished colleagues James Charlesworth, who published an entire booklet on the Terapeia fragment from Qumran, in which he discovered the medical and theological idea anticipating the teaching of Christ, and on which Yosef Nave published a three-page review showing that there were scribal exercises. And this is how this text remains, and none of the great ideas discovered by Charlesworth but stays. I could tell the story of the great prophecy on the fall of Constantinople, read on Constantine's sarcophagus by the learned patriarch Gennadius Scholarius. The interesting thing about this prophecy is that it was written only in consonants. It was written only in consonants. That is, Scholarius read the consonants, he completed the vowels, and got a complete prophecy on the fall of Constantinople. Surprisingly, for Constantine's age, it was written in the Greek of the 15th century, and the sarcophagus is still preserved in the Museum in Istanbul. So you can go and try to find traces of any inscription. I'll terminate with a sad story of a distinguished French epigraphist who published a whole book of Etruscan inscriptions, which only he could see. I don't see, decipher, but only he could see. Such things happen, believe me, they really happen. When you read afterwards, when you look afterwards, you see that there are fibers of the papyrus which made perfect sense to you the day before. Constantine read an inscription. I believe that he found a cup, and that on that cup he read an inscription. Constantine read it not in the life of Constantine, we have this strange indication that it was written in Samaritan and in Hebrew. This was differently commented, and I think the pertinent explanation which has been proposed is that simply Constantine knew that at the time of Solomon, Hebrew was written in Samaritan script. That was less clear to the author of his life, who did not tell the story correctly. There were not two inscriptions, that it was an inscription partly in one Hebrew script and partly in another. What they want to say is that simply it was written in ancient Hebrew script, not in a normal Hebrew script. In this script, you can read absolutely everything. And that's precisely the text that Constantine read. This text is the first, the absolutely first, and in that case, in this respect, it fits very well the problem of this conference. This is the first text translated from Hebrew into Slavonic. And I think it doesn't matter in the list that this text did not exist at all. Okay, the context of the question is about the context of the text in the manuscript. The text, that's very interesting. Both texts have no context in both manuscripts. The Scorialensis, the manuscript from Scorial, which was used by, which was discovered, in which the text was discovered by Shevchenko, probably an 11th century, some say 12th, some say 10th century manuscript, in which it appears in a kind of, at the end, in the miscellaneous collection, very, very different short text, and Shevchenko could make no connection between them. The text from the Bodleiana, which is even earlier, it's 10th century manuscript, in which Rainer Stichel discarded his text, if my memory doesn't betray me, it's a Psalter. And then simply, that's simply added. Yeah, it's simply added without any context. That is, to that extent, that strengthens the idea that it's not an ancient text which was transmitted as part of kind of any literary compendium as such short texts are usually transmitted. It's a text which fairly shortly after Constantine's time, was copied out of context, both times out of context, twice.
It is connected with Psoka.
It's not befitting. It's a good place for it. Yes, good place. Yeah.
Psoma, especially. You know, yeah. What happened?
Yeah, I don't know where that is. We really need the Stephen's edition, you know. Because of course, everybody can go and look in Bodleiana, but yes. that's not a procedure.
Yes, a lot of questions. Moshe,
there is a question. No, first of all, I would like to congratulate you. Really, it's an exciting project. I have only one major comment. That you're opening the mark. You cannot publish. Of course, you can publish.
No. Yes.
Of course you can. What do you mean? Somebody is keeping his filing for 20 years. Of course you can publish it. And you have something to say. Go ahead and publish it.
No.
It is published yet.
No, this is
you should publish it.
This is not for publication. This is Rainer Stichl's discovery. Oh, he's the only one.
Okay, no, so you mentioned his name.
No.
Okay, you mentioned it. You give him credit. I stated my
position on the subject. That is,
I think you should do so publicly.
Yes, you must publish.
You must publish it. By
the end of this day.
You must publish it.
I mean, this is not the best you scroll.
Okay, other questions. Questions other than concerning the ontology.
Sorry, yeah. Victor.
Just a short comment. I could recreate you with a brilliant reading of the text. I do like it very much. But I don't understand how and where Sin comes into this picture. Because we can do without zero with this distribution. I remember how Mario Kamalda told me some 20 years ago that she believed that he believed that chance really existed in Kazakhstan. And then I thought that Mario was absolutely mad. But I didn't think that she would have won. There are many inconsistencies in this part of the Constantine's life. So there are many grounds on which we can negate its historical veracity. Not only this story of this strange chapter.
Yes.
And I don't know why we should construct all this complicated picture of Constantine sitting in Constantinople, knowing Hebrew, and at the same time knowing something from Samaritan letters. I think that it is much better to think that there was an apocrypha existing in a strange way. We have only small remnants of it.
I would like to respond, but as you prefer. This is a very, very substantial objection. Why Constantine? Constantine because of Samaritan. Samaritan has nothing to do in this story. Samaritan has strictly nothing to do with in the story. There are three holy languages. There is Greek, there is Latin, and there is Hebrew. If anyone composes an apocrypha, he will compose an apocrypha in Greek or in Slavonic with an inscription either in Hebrew or in the three languages that I named. Samaritan has nothing to do for the confirmation of the apocrypha. Samaritan is part of biography of Constantine philosopher. It's entirely private detail. It simply happened that he learned Samaritan. It has no meaning. You see, what's so funny amusing in many studies about the life of Constantine is the attempt to construct it as a perfectly coherent text that is better conceived than Pentateuch by God, you know. We have this attitude in many fields. You imagine some kind of perfect text, and whatever doesn't fit into this perfection, into this perfect idea of the text, appears either as interpolation or as a proof that this text is not authentic. Perfect texts don't exist. The fact that Constantine the philosopher learned Samaritan has no meaning in life, has absolute no meaning. He was supposed to know Hebrew. He was supposed to know Hebrew in order to debate with the Jews. Samaritan is totally irrelevant detail. The only explanation of this detail that I can see is that he learned. The only explanation of Samaritan in relation to this inscription is that this inscription is related to Constantine the philosopher. That's how I see it. I think Samaritan is the key.
So the Greek text was translated from Slavonic.
No. That's what, not what I said. That is, the Greek text. It's very hard, you know. I was convinced for a long time that the Greek text was translated from Slavonic, but.
The life of our Samaritan is presented as a language without grammar, but there's a Constantine learns Hebrew by reading the eight parts of speech, the same grammar of Hebrew, whereas he prays to gain knowledge of Samaritan. And in that way, it fits in the represent the contrast. You see, he's able to learn languages, let's say, the standard academic way. He's also able to receive languages.
He didn't receive it directly. It's described because he met the Samaritan. He met Samaritan and he impressed the Samaritan with his knowledge. See, I don't see any symbolic value in the fact in this episode of some. It's actually more interesting as a stray fact.
Right.
Association with this Jeremiah apocryphal or Marian, the wood of Christ's crucifixion. Can there be any?
I don't know this text. I don't know the Jeremiah apocryphal.
That's okay. Very pleasant to have you.
I think this Samaritan issue is more complicated. First of all, there's no Samaritan language and there's Samaritan script.
Samaritan language. Have you heard how the Samaritans read the Torah, for example?
Even Samaritan version of reading Hebrew.
It's very different from the Hebrew version of reading Hebrew. That is, without some training, you will not understand it.
Then in the second, do we know anything about Samaritans outside Palestine, Samaritans in the Crimea, where Constantine was supposed to meet a Samaritan?
Yeah, we know, because the life of course.
But there was Samaritan to the Crimea.
No, since the Samaritan is described in the life of Constantine,
okay.
I have no reason to doubt. I have no reason to doubt that he was there. But we have no sources in 9th century.
Not contextual detail. I just question you read this, chalice made of wood, or its content was made from the wood?
No, it was created, Сотворена, so that навкушение Господне древо иного, so that God might taste from the other tree.
Ah, so it's not a wooden tree, not a wooden chalice. Okay.
No. The term used in the Revelation of John is also kusulo.
Because we just recently received one paper related with this matter.
It's from Slovakia,
and it will be very interesting to see two opinions, and I would like to invite everyone who have some commentary to publish his opinion.
Could I make a suggestion? You can in fact publish your interpretation of this text and refer to the information which has been supplied by Linus Torvalds earlier without actually publishing the text as a text.
Well, it's complicated.
It's possible.
It's complicated. The text, we didn't discuss the text, but his text is not uninteresting. And it certainly supports my interpretation. As you could see, is Gelsin Ufes Curio to Luther. That is, that's, it's not created. That is, Ufes, there are two possible ways to interpret this form, but whatever form it is, it's not Sotvarina. You can't work with it as with the Slavonic.
Has Degelet actually expressed any intention eventually of publishing this?
Of course he expressed the intention, but in his opinion, this is an ancient Jewish Christian apocrypha. And to the extent that I don't think that this thesis can be proven, I don't see how he can publish.
You can find a way around it.
But,
thank you very much. A lot of questions, but we have to finish quite quick.
The Book of Ben Sira, called in the Eastern Orthodox tradition the Wisdom of Jesus, Song of Sira, is one of the minutely studied books of the Bible. Over 3,000 editions and studies of it have been recorded in the 1475-1998 period alone, and most of these were in the 19th and the 20th century. Six special scholarly forms dedicated to the problems linked with the Book of Ben Sira were held within the past 15 years, and in the same period several large volumes were published in connection with it. A considerable number of problems have been studied in this enormous amount of publications. At the same time, however, many problems continue to be the subject of discussions, and many questions remain open. In this boundless literature, consisting of hundreds of thousands of pages, which has dealt with a vast number of subjects, there is not a single line about the Slavonic translation of the book made in Great Moravia already in the 9th century, most probably by Saint Methodius, in cooperation with his disciples, nor anything about the development of its text during the Middle Ages among the Eastern Orthodox Slavs and among the Catholic Slavs in the Croatian lands where the translation was disseminated. The first Slavonic translation of the Book of Sira and its history in the Slavic world have been ignored so far due to a large extent to the fact that translation has not been studied at all and has not even been published. During the last decade, I have been working on the first scholarly edition of the full text of the book on the basis of its earliest text in chronological respect, a text which is one Bulgarian manuscript from the Russian National Library, F1461, and published a number of studies on it, including on the text of Sirach. The codex is of exceptional interest, not only because it includes the old Slavonic full copy of the book, and because it presents the first Slavonic translation made by Saint Methodius in the earliest stage of the use of Slavonic alphabet, but also because it is the first attempt in Slavic world to gather in one volume the books of the Old Testament. I think it is high time for the history of this translation and its textual tradition to be included within the range of studies on the early translations of the Book of Ben Sira, together with studies on the Greek, Latin, Syriac, Aramaic, Arabic, Armenian, Coptic, and Georgian texts, which have been attracting the attention of scholars ever since the 19th century. Basing my work on the earliest full text, this Bulgarian copy, I shall dwell only on one problem that, in my opinion, is important one. This is the problem of the composition of the text. I shall know, however, that my investigation of these problems are yet incomplete, and the results given here will be presented in the future. When saying all this, I still want to note that this should not be understood in the sense that there have been no studies on the Slavonic texts of the book, even on sacred matters. Already in the beginning of the 19th century, in scholarly literature, there began to appear information about its texts in the literature of the Eastern Orthodox Slavs. In them, one finds also the first opinion about the composition and character of the Slavonic text. It's based on an analysis of the first entire codex of the Bible known among the Eastern Orthodox Slavs as Gennady's Bible. The authors of description of this manuscript, Gorsky and Neverstoyev, know that the absence of the prologue and the translation of the book from the Hebrew into Greek. They direct the attention of the reader to the fact that the order and the size of chapters 30, 36, which differ in the Greek and Latin manuscripts of Vulgate, here have been brought into agreement with the Latin text, and the book has been named Ecclesiasticus in the inscriptions of the sheets of the codex. Concerning the translation itself, in their view, it follows the reduction of the Vatican Greek manuscript, but there are readings that correspond to other Greek manuscripts too. 140 years later, Francis Thompson again pointed out to the absence of the prologue and thinks that the most of the readings come rather from the Vatican Greek manuscript than from the Alexandrinian manuscript. that there are missing verses, as he calls them, and indicates several differences in that respect between the Croatian First Brevnitsa Glagolitic Breviary of the 13th, 14th centuries, published in 1910 by Josef Weiss, which is a part of the liturgical books of the Croatian Catholics and the full copy. As can be seen from these studies, to this day there has been no idea about the composition of the text, namely about the delimitation of the parts of the text by the first Slavonic translator, neither in full nor in any of its manuscript text. What is the composition of the text in the Bulgarian manuscript from St. Petersburg? From the chart that you have, it is clear that the separation of its parts does not coincide with the division accepted in the critical edition of Josef Ziegler by 1965, which reflects the composition of pre-Septuagint. This edition is based on the wide use of enormous number of manuscripts of the different translations of the book, but in practice, the main place in it has been given to the known three earliest representatives of the text of the Septuagint: the Uncial Vatican manuscripts of the 4th century, the Sinai manuscript of the 4th century, and the Alexandrinian manuscript of the 5th century. They are told to reflect in the best way this proto-text known among scholars as the oldest text considered so far and called G1. It can be seen also that only in 6 of the 8 cases you may see on the chart in which Ziegler accepts the titles as part of the text, the titles of the separate semantic entities delimited in the Bulgarian manuscript coincide as to their place and name with the Greek ones. These are before chapter 18, 20, 24, 13, 44, and 51. One is impressed also by the fact that minuscule manuscript 248, Vaticanus Gregus 336 of the 13th century, published in 1909 in Cambridge by Hart, and considered to be the main representative of Lukian's reduction, has besides these 5 titles another 3 you may see on the chart, these 3 cases. None of them is in the St. Petersburg manuscript. But on the other hand, it has another 17 titles that are not in Ziegler's edition, nor in that of Hart. Regretfully, however, almost no attention has been dedicated to these titles, and for the time being, it is not possible to say whether they are linked with a tradition that exists in other translations of the book. A part of them are also in the later Russian copies of the 15th and 16th century, some of which change them and sometimes supplement them with those that are is not in St. Petersburg manuscript. Whatever is their origin, however, no doubt that they are the result of the striving to turn special attention to some verses. This is witnessed too by the fact that in some cases the titles separate very small textual entities. Their numerous presence may be due to the not quite clear understanding by the scribes of the entire composition of the book, which is not very clear as it is. The evidence that the separate parts of the book were not delimited categorically when it was created lies in the fact that even the scholars conducting research on the text are not of one opinion with regard to their delimitation. Even today, there exist different opinions in that respect, and these were generalized very well recently by Otto Mulder in 2003. Moreover, it is significant that the composition suggested by scholars does not at all coincide with the one of the Greek prototexts of Ziegler. You may see, for example, the composition suggested by Patrick Skevin and Alexander Di Lello in 1987 Anchor Bible. Scholars are unanimous, most frequently concerning the separation into larger or smaller parts in the cases with the titles before 24.1, 44.1, and 51.1. There are also different interpretations of the titles. They are defined either as arbitrary interpolations or reliable principles for delimitating textual entities. It is beyond doubt that some of the titles belong to the Hebrew text. This is the case with the title before 44.1, you all may see, which is in manuscript B from the Cairo Geniza and is almost identical with the title in the Greek and the Slavonic text. It is a pity that there are no findings concerning the titles in a larger number of Greek manuscripts. And one cannot say in the if the older Slavonic translation follows one of them. It is interesting, however, to note that two of the titles in the St. Petersburg manuscript are closely linked in their content with one of the titles in the Hebrew manuscript that has been pointed to, and that the first of these titles is at the same place. These are the titles before 34.12 and 34.25, which in manuscript B are united into one before 31.12 and are on sheet 4 recto, line 1, before the beginning of the text and mark its content in an exact manner, teaching concerning eating and drinking wine together. Here is not superfluous to recall that manuscript B is the most extensive Hebrew text discovered so far, 19 leaves from the 12th century, which contain the bulk of the text after chapter 30.11. And moreover, they have been written while keeping the stichometrical structure of the text. This is the only one that has titles, and these have been put in the beginning of the list. Both titles in it are not there by chance, but are linked with the content. The parts that they denote are well delimited and obviously were understood exactly as delimited entities of the text, both by Hebrew scribe and by the Greek copyist and also by the Slavonic one. When I say that the earliest Slavonic translation of the Book of Ben Sira has retained the original composition of the text, there immediately emerged the question as to what is the size and character of the translated text, and hence what is its source. The comparison with the data known today about the Greek text shows that the old Bulgarian translation reflects rather exactly the earliest Greek text, the so-called G1. It lacks almost all cola and verses that are characteristic of the later Greek reduction called G2, in which the text is largest and the additional text usually are the third and fourth column in the verse. These texts in G2, which are not in the Petersburg manuscript, are more than 120, as well as the prologue. Here, I must add immediately that according to Ziegler, Most of these places are found only in the Greek manuscripts representatives of Lukian's reduction, but some are present also in Origen's text and the Hebrew writes. Of course, in the Bulgarian manuscript, there are also some missing places more. Only six verses from six chapters, but they belong already to the original translation, which is demonstrated by the absence of the first two texts also in the Croatian text, which had been preserved only up to chapter 6. I shall point out that in the Petersburg manuscript, there were, however, also several places that, according to Ziegler, belong to the expanded Greek reduction G2, seven verses from four chapters. These also are not individual features of his text, because the first three are also in the Croatian texts. Besides, one should point out that in the first two cases, in chapter 1, the text is available not in Lukian's reduction, but already in Origen's text, and all the rest are in the available Hebrew manuscript. At that one should stress that column 198, which is missing in Origen's text and in Lukian's one, is accepted as a part of the proto-text only because it exists in the basic uncial manuscript, but is witness to also in the oldest Hebrew text from Masada. Bearing in mind the composition of the text of Ben Sira in Bulgarian manuscript, one finds that it is extremely close to the body of the oldest Greek text and not to Lukian's reduction, and that as a rule it has used verses consisting of two paula, which is characteristic also of the structure of the oldest Greek text as well as of the Hebrew text. This finding inevitably leads to the question whether this means that Methodius' translation was made on the basis of the earliest Greek text G1 or even on the basis of very old manuscripts from 4th, 5th centuries, which would mean that it is very close also to the original Hebrew text. If that is so, the value of this translation for making people familiar with the early history of the text of the Book of Ben Sira would grow considerably, and its study inevitably would cause the interest not only of Slavonic scholars. Thank you for your attention.
We have 7 minutes, yes? For questions and comments, please. If everybody wants. Yes.
I'm not a biblicist. I'm not the son of a biblicist, and I'm not the grandson of a biblicist.
Having said that, I just wanted to mention
that what you are discussing, Ben Sira, in context, I believe it's just a marginal note. It's important to mention that the Slavic text that we're dealing with is there for 1,000 years, and Hebrew texts that we are dealing with are 100 or 110 years. I believe it's just important to remind everybody that we are dealing with two texts. One is chapter text. The chapter identified and was thrilled to realize that he's dealing with allegedly the original version of this here. And another text is the one you mentioned, which was found, which was discovered 50 years later, 6 years later, in Masada. So we have two different Hebrew texts, both of them are late 19th and mid 20th century, whatever is their date. They were not circulated, we did not see them over the last 2,000 years. Over the last 2,000 years, the Jewish tradition dealt with many attempts to translate the Ben Sira text from the Greek back in the Hebrew, we have about 80 different Hebrew translations which have nothing to do with the original text, but which express the desire of Jews to have this text within the corpus, but this word just, I would say, later translations and inventions. So when you say Ben Sira, you compare it to Hebrew texts, I believe it's important to mention the Hebrew texts that you are mentioning are 20th century texts, right? According to the time when they were discovered.
May I answer?
Yes.
This is a difficult question, of course, but the scholars who dealt with the text of Ben Sira think that these fragments from Cairo, Geniza, one small fragment from Masada, also there is one small fragment in Qumran manuscripts, reflects a very good the original Hebrew text. I don't know. I am not a specialist in this field, but I trust my colleagues who have dealt with this matter. I'm sorry, but Hebrew text is not known as a whole.
Yeah,
now
both
we have only two-thirds of the text. And the text from the earliest one is the text from Masada, you know very well. Then the text from Qumran, small fragments. And
yeah, these are original texts. I'm not saying
other manuscripts are from 12th century, from Cairo Geniza.
Right, but neither of them circulated. That's
and
that's
I don't know. My colleagues who dealt with the original Hebrew text, there is many scholars who, Alexander Dilela, for example, is one of them, a very authoritative scholar. They think this is the original Hebrew text, really. I don't know if this is the truth.
Yes.
But
yes.
I trust them.
Okay. What are that? What are the questions? I said.
Thank you very much.